So thank you, everybody. And I think we're all very stimulated by the first panel, the coffee, and the conversation at the break. Now I want to invite you on a shilling safari, or follow the money tour of East Africa, and looking at some of the issues that are being raised by the incoming oil and gas wealth in the countries that we're focusing on. We have a great lineup of people who are on the ground dealing with these issues in real time in Mozambique, Tanzania, Kenya, Uganda, and also to have a perspective of a country that relatively recently started producing oil, Ghana, to share some lessons with us about the challenges that Ghana has faced, but also some of the achievements since they started producing oil in 2010. I think as was reflected in Oxfam's Vice President's speech, Paul O'Brien, there's a big leap between transparency and accountability, but transparency is a huge first step. The changed normative framework globally from today to 10 years ago is profound, especially around transparency. 10 years ago, when I co-authored a report called Bottom of the Barrel with Professor Terry Lynn Carl, Stanford, there really wasn't an EITI. There wasn't a Dodd-Frank law. There wasn't an EU law. There wasn't an open contracting partnership. There wasn't an open government partnership. So instead of just starting to raise these issues, we now have a plethora of initiatives. And the challenge is making this transparency industrial complex, which I sometimes call it, something that's useful on the ground to people. So we'll be discussing both these frameworks, both globally and nationally, but what other steps need to be taken to really walk that last mile so that the revenues that are generated, the billions of dollars that are coming into the system in these countries will actually have an effect on the lives of the people. And without further ado, I want to start with my panelists. I'd like to invite Prosper Ngoi, who is a professor of economics from Mzumbe University in Tanzania, to give some reflections on Tanzania.
Thank you. Specifically, I'll be talking about options that exist for turning the expected, I'm saying expected because it's yet to start flowing, the expected natural resource revenues into poverty reduction in Tanzania. We are talking in the context of a country that has just discovered a colossal amount of commercial quantities of natural gas in southern Tanzania, Mtwara, Lindi, and partly coast region in Tanzania. And operations are starting to some extent, but then we are yet to see revenues. We are expecting to see natural gas and possibly oil revenues coming into the system maybe some 7 or 10 years from now. But then 7, 10 years from now are not really so far away. It's good really to start putting things in place very early. So again, we are talking in the context where it's a country where out of, you know, about 33% of its 47.7 million people are poor, you know, are living on poverty. More than 4 million people are on extreme poverty. But then it's a country where for the past 50 years, you know, because natural gas is not the first natural resource that we are having. For the past 40 years, we have been having natural resources in terms of gold, in terms of, you know, gemstones like Tanzanite, in terms of, you know, diamond, you name it, all of it, but then still poor. So we are saying, are we going to miss it again this time around with gas? And if we do it, for sure, we are going to be the laughing stock of the world. And I think not only the country, but also those of us who are supposed to be advising the country, to be helping the country in various ways. So we are talking again in this context where we have huge expectations on what should be done with the money. And we are, you know, a number of decisions are yet to be done in as far as I understand. You know, I've done a number of pieces on oil and gas economy, asking whether Tanzania is ready to be oil and gas economy, whether we have plans and systems in place to make sure that when the money starts coming, we are really going to use it properly. We have seen from our friends in Ghana, somehow they have started using their oil money. Of course, still the question is the money being used properly? So in Tanzanian context, I will zero in on the options that exist for using the money for a poverty reduction, you know, in a proper way. So we would say naturally we would expect the money to be invested, part of it, of course, to be invested, you know, part of it will be consumed, part of it will be saved, you know, a typical macroeconomic equation. But then the money that will be consumed, you would expect to be consumed in a proper way, you know, part of it. Like investing in human resource development, that is investing in education, investing in health. This debate is not really new, but then what is new is most of the debates that are coming up in Tanzania on how to use money for human capital development, really we are not really zeroing into a proper education, into proper health services, you know, investing in schools, investing in research and development, investing in health systems, investing in educational, in kind of, you know, vocational training. Because I think most of us who are here, at least the way I understand the background of most of my friends from Africa, maybe wouldn't have been here had it not been investment in our education. Yeah, whether the education of ourselves or our parents, maybe won't have been here. So we see education, investment in education, to be among the good avenues of escaping poverty at individual level, at household level, but also at the country level. So, and you know, when you're talking about oil and gas money, it's money that is not like any other money. It's very peculiar amount, type of money. You know, it's amount of money that will come with a lot of volatility, as we have heard. You know, it's a amount that of money that is coming from very finite resources that will not be until forever, because on Earth it didn't come to stay forever. So if it is not well spent, then you know, we remain to suffer forever again. So on top of using the money on proper investment in terms of human capital development, other options that exist will be now investing in proper infrastructure. Again, the debate of investing oil and gas money in infrastructure is there, but then it's too general in my view. You know, infrastructure, yes, could be roads, could be railways, could be ports, could be airports, could be internet facility. Those are both infrastructure, you know, soft and hard infrastructure. But really, there is little focus, little discussion, little discourses on proper infrastructure, like in rural roads that would connect households, smallholder farmers, to markets, you know, that will connect them to service provision points, to hospitals, et cetera, et cetera. We have a number of stories of women who are unable to go to hospital to deliver just because of bad roads, but because of the bridges that do not exist. You know, it's those kind of thinking, I think are not yet there. When we're thinking of investment in roads, we mainly think of, you know, there's huge roads, there's huge ports and airports, you know, and then we forget what I think would be the basics. Again, infrastructure could include electricity, but then when we are discussing investment infrastructure, we think mainly electricity to power the industries and factories. It's okay, but again, we hardly talk about rural electrification, you know. Thinking of the role of rural electrification and how it could really unlock a lot of potentials for economic growth, a lot of potentials for poverty reduction, you know, cannot be overemphasized. You know, there are a lot of young men and women, especially the child girl, who is unable to go to school or goes to school but then cannot read just because there isn't electricity in her village. And this could be really one of the things that could emancipate them, that could transform their lives if there is investment of part of the oil and gas money into infrastructure like rural electrification. You know, it could go into irrigation dams, et cetera, et cetera. Those who are doing agriculture would understand part of the challenges that most farmers, smallholder farmers, are facing, and Oxfam knows this very much. It's, you know, lack of irrigation systems and all this. So to what extent will we invest this money to kind of provide irrigation systems, dams, and all this, markets that are poor, you know? So I think part of good decisions should be made exactly now. And our worry is, are we really making those decisions? The decision makers, are they thinking ahead? Or will they wait until when the cash is at hand and then they start thinking? And I think it will be too late. Again, maybe to wind up again, you know, we have been thinking of you know, using the money in a proper way through distribution and redistribution. Now that we expect that the government at least would have some cash, you know, the petrodollar, it can afford really doing some exemptions on taxation of goods and services that have been consumed by the poor. You know, that is called a pro-poor taxation. We are discussing a little bit on issues of subsidies, subsidizing goods and services that are consumed by the poor, you know, those kind of things. And I'm told the time is up, but there will be discussion, I'm sure. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prosper. And going a little bit south on our safari, I wanted to invite Adriano Navunga, who is the Executive Director of the Center for Public Integrity in Mozambique. Thank you very much, Adriano.
Morning, everyone. My name is Adriano Navunga from the Center for Public Integrity. I'm going to share with you a few ideas on the developments of the extractive sector in Mozambique. Well, according to conventional wisdom, Mozambique is experiencing a gas boom. And the sector is growing fast, but expectations are growing faster. Of course, while the class reserves were announced by Anadarko, American US company, and ANI, Italian company, that put Mozambique, although there is not yet a third-party confirmation of the reserves, but reports put Mozambique amongst the top 15 countries in terms of reserves only. But this gas is found almost in the middle of nowhere, in the north of Mozambique, border with Tanzania. And because there is no high demand on gas, domestic for natural gas, the only viable option for Mozambique is LNG to be exported for Asian markets. This brings me to the issue of timings and the scale of exports. Given that the quantities of reserves, it is high, the issue now is when can this gas be exported? And optimistic scenarios, they say that if the first train is exported by the 2020s, it will be an extraordinary achievement. Given that, this gas is found in one of the poorest part and literally middle of nowhere in the northern Mozambique. So the challenges are high. And the issues of how much can be exported, most of the estimates are based on a 10 trains LNG facilities, but this seems to be unrealistic. There are no independent analysis of how much can be done, but the estimates of 10 LNG facilities that would put Mozambique as the second most expensive energy project in the world. It is not realistic. So some of the projections which are based on 10 LNG facilities tend not to be realistic. We think based on the information that is circulating from the industry in Maputo that there will be not more than two LNG facilities by 2020s. Well, the issue now is it a good deal for Mozambique? Everyone look at it as a game changer for a poor, aid-dependent country. And it seems that, yes, statistics of macroeconomic growth, obviously, they will increase. But how much will that benefit the people of the country? Considering that LNG, it's high-tech type of industry, we think that there will be massive jobs in the face of development. But when it comes to how this workforce will be, whether will be absorbed in the face of the project implementation, that is not realistic. So for us, we look at it as a project that will give jobs in the beginning, but because of the low capacity in the workforce of Mozambique and combined with the high-tech type of projects, it seems that even the very basic spin-offs that other countries have benefited of, Mozambique will not benefit of that. So we think that Mozambique will only benefit in terms of revenues for government. But how much will be going for government? Looking at the current contracts that we have access to and we analyze them, all these contracts, they are reloaded from the government perspective. So it will be money coming for government, but at a late stage in terms of all. So there are really high risks here in terms of, so it is big opportunity, but with high risks of corruption. Government have put in place a number of anti-corruption reforms, but considering Mozambique is, it has a dominant party system with a strong economic and political elite that control and dominates the sector. There are really serious challenges, the extent to which that will be a pro-poor developmental. So natural gas finds in northern Mozambique really high opportunity for development of the country. But in terms of timing, even the best scenario, there won't be money for government before 2020s. And even there, for the people in the rural area to benefit, it won't be before 2030s. Because as I said, contracts are so reloaded from government perspective. Transparency and accountability, including public institutions, are key to ensure that everything will go in the right direction. So it's a huge opportunity with risks in the middle and with some uncertainty as to what extent transparency and accountability will be in play. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Adrianu. I'd like to invite Charles Wangu, who is the Kenya Civil Society Platform on Oil and Gas Coordinator, to give some remarks on Kenya. I know, Charles, that we heard a fair amount about Kenya in the first panel, but mostly from the perspective of the issues on the ground in Turkana. So maybe looking at some of the transparency issues and the financial issues as they're playing out in Kenya would be great.
Thanks, Ian. I will try not to be too repetitive. I'm very honored to speak on this panel, which seems to be the black suit panel, because a lot of our countries are sort of in the red, and we're happy to get in the black. So Kenya is undergoing several transitions, not only constitutional, but economic and political as well. Due to time, I'll sort of limit myself to sort of two transitions. So the first transition is the constitutional transition. Kenyans overwhelmingly voted for a very progressive constitution in 2010, which one of the key things under that was devolution. So we are currently going through the first fast lot of county governments, and with that, there's sort of the several growing pains as these nascent county governments try to deliver on the promise of devolution. Similarly, at the national level, the shift from the parliamentary to a presidential system has also sort of faced some challenges in sort of people transiting to the new order. For example, the budget-making role of parliament still seems to be in its nascent stages as well. Similarly, the Constitution of 2010 gives broad provisions on public participation for citizens of Kenya. This has not been applied so far in a uniform manner. The second transition I'd like to talk about is a political transition. After the last election, we were seen to have moved to what we are calling the digital age, and we elected a sort of a relatively young president. I say relatively young because the previous transition was from a 78-year-old to a 70-year-old, and now we've moved from an 80-year-old to a 50-odd-old. So I mean, it's a significant a shift. So, but with that, they were elected on a platform of youth. And we do understand, I mean, with our youth bulge, it's a significant challenge. To put that in context, in 2003, Kenya implemented a free primary education system. And now we are seeing a lot of those sort of 1.3 million students who joined primary education then are now joining the workforce to an economy which is not delivering anything close to that in terms of jobs. Another, in terms of political transition as well, we have moved now to our second coalition government, and the inherent challenges, as we all know, of coalition governments. At this point as well, I'd like to sort of highlight one key gap as well. As Kenya shifted from a focus on regulation at the line ministry level to more professional and independent regulatory bodies, and we are finding that you know some of these organizations who are tasked with key regulatory roles like NEMA and the Energy Regulatory Commission are still very, very, very young institutions who are still sort of trying to find their feet, and not only in the budgetary aspect, but also sort of being delinked from their line ministries. So that is a significant challenge, I mean, for companies operating in the sector. Let's go to sort of the implications of the constitutional transition on the oil fines. Firstly, the constitution has a provision on access to information that stipulates that all citizens have access to information held by government. This so far has not been achieved. Similarly, all natural resource contracts have to be ratified by parliament. So since 2010, this again has not been significantly achieved as we're moving forward. The constitution also, in Article 201, prioritizes expenditure for any revenue that is received. And it stipulates that expenditure shall promote the equitable development of the country, including by making special provision for marginalized groups and areas. You will find that a lot of the areas where the fines are being found now are largely marginalized groups in those areas. Similarly, the constitutional has an impact on oil policy as we move forward. So legislation that is going through, for example, the energy bill, should include a transparency provision as well as local content to enhance equity in the host communities. And I think technical assistance projects that are going on towards the government should take cognizance of this, as they're not operating in a vacuum, as the constitution is sort of the leading document. I'll go to sort of the implications of the fines. I mean, the oil fines, it changes the face of development in Kenya. I'll try not to repeat what Ikal mentioned in terms of the traditional geography of development. But majority of the development has been from the coast towards the west along the railway line. Sort of 10 kilometers each side of the railway line is where traditional development has happened. Again, the oil fines are not in those areas, with the exception of the block on Lake Victoria. Similarly, so a shift will have to be made in terms of allocation of resources to these areas. And we're already seeing that initially with the big talk of infrastructure around the fines in the Lapsot project, which is a transport corridor from the coast linking South Sudan and Ethiopia as well. But it's important that that infrastructure, it's not only infrastructure that goes in, but infrastructure is followed by services for a lot of these areas which have not traditionally had access to any services. The oil finds also have some interesting regional dynamics. The Ilemi Triangle in North Turkana sort of borders South Sudan, and it's sort of a contested area. So, I mean, there's a possibility there of sort of future conflict around any concessions issued there. Similarly, offshore, the border, Kenya's border with Somalia, will have a similar challenge in terms of concessions. So I think at this early juncture, just like our brothers in West Africa have done, there has to start some discussions around joint development of resources in contested areas. Lastly, I'll go to my pet project. The civil society platform on oil and gas seeks to give a collective civil society voice on oil and gas issues. And so therefore, I mean, civil society is open for constructive engagement in the developing of policy options, in community engagement, in promoting transparency, not only at the national level, but at the county level as well. And a lot of our members are already engaging at the county level. And sort of lastly, I mean, it is crucial that this space is maintained. I won't sort of repeat what Paul mentioned in his opening remarks, that we are seeing a closing civil society space where civil society is sort of seen as abrasive. So, I mean, I must say that civil society is open for engagement, even if it involves some of us dusting our coats. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Charles. I'd like to turn to Godber Tumushabe in Uganda. Uganda will inevitably have to export its oil, oil isn't refined, through Kenya. But Godber, you've been working on these oil issues for a number of years in Uganda, and so I'd like you to share your reflections.
Yeah, thank you, Ian, and thank you, Brookings and Oxfam, for the invitation. Just to put my presentation in context, for some of you who may not know Uganda very well, Uganda is a country that is almost half the size of California. Its population is only 3 million less than the population of California. So you are really talking of a fairly heavily populated country with the second highest growth rate, population growth rate in the world, and one of the highest fertility rates, I think estimated at 7.2 children per mother. In macroeconomic terms, the economists tell us that we've made very, very tremendous progress over the last two decades. Impressive economic growth rates, estimated at at an average of 5%, stable inflation, but also declining infant mortality and maternal mortality, and increased school enrollment. So in macroeconomic terms, you can say this is a country that is really on the move. In micro economic terms, I think you see major challenges in terms of low primary school completion rates, currently estimated at about 23%, low transition rates, a sick health delivery system, because the health system is really sick, and a declining agricultural sector and worsening youth unemployment. I think current statistics show that out of every 100 youth, 83 are unemployed. So that is the nature of Uganda's economy, essentially progress, but also challenges. So comes into the oil. And I think I want to re-echo the point that Prosper made, that the discovery of oil is really not the only thing, the only good thing that has happened to many of these countries, including Uganda. I think one of the British Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, called Uganda the Pearl of Africa, because you can go anywhere in that country, you find water flowing, things growing, without having to worry about so much. So this is a country that is naturally rich. But I think the discovery of oil definitely becomes a game changer. the oil estimates, the estimated reserves are current at about 3.5 billion barrels, estimated to bring in about $2 billion per year. $2 billion is slightly half than Uganda's budget for 2011-12, but also more than the amount of foreign aid that came into Uganda in 2010, which is estimated at $1.7 billion. So this is a really huge inflows. I should mention that the key players now in Uganda are the three major companies, Tullow Oil, Sinuk China, and Total France. Now, of course, the China playing in a country like Uganda is a serious game changer in terms of the way the industry operates and how it is run. But let me mention that that is the opportunity. And I think I want to make sure that from here, we need to stop talking about this whole idea of the resource curse, because there is no resource that can be a curse. I think a resource is an opportunity. What is a curse is the governance. How that resource is governed and managed is what we should be calling the resource curse. And I think that's where Uganda finds itself in terms of having major problems. That Uganda is one country around this world where for 50 years, for half a century of independence, we haven't been able to have a successful and peaceful transition of power from one president to another or from one political party to another. It has either been coups, or our current president has, for the last 28 years, been able to succeed himself. And we are still going on. Secondly, let me say that there is this, in the discourse on oil, there is also a profound naivety that when you put the laws in place, you fix the problem. And I think that, yes, the laws are good, but they are just a small equation in the calculus that oil governance is about. So there is quite a lot of effort put, whether from the citizens, from the governments, from the development partners, that you need to deal with the laws. Yes, well and good. But the laws, you have countries around the African continent, including Uganda, where we say you have laws, but you don't have the rule of law. You have constitutions, but you don't have constitutionalism. And that's a fundamentally different field in how you play. Thirdly, the biggest danger of countries like Uganda is that they are experiencing democratic reversals, and how oil comes in and either facilitates that reversal is a major problem. I think the colleague Charles talked about the space for civil society. In Uganda, we are seeing the enactment of the most retrogressive pieces of legislation against civil liberties. And you can outline many of them on media, public order management. There is a proposed legislation today about NGOs, which is already in the works. And I think that is one of the most draconian NGO legislation you can find in the world. So it is very easy for us to talk, including for government, to say, oh, there is the open government initiative, there is this initiative, and there is the other one. And then we keep quiet about some of these processes that are going on. And governments are always happy to be able to move, especially when they know people are keeping quiet. Let me end by suggesting about three things that really we need to focus on as part of the discourse. One is that in Uganda, you have to, whether you like it or not, you have to deal with the managing the politics of transition. That is going to be very important on whether that oil benefits Ugandans or not. Secondly, safeguarding space for civil society, because in societies where citizens are not civically empowered, you are really dealing with civil society as potential vehicles for participation and engagement. Thirdly, there is a public finance bill that is currently being formulated, and I think institutions like the World Bank can play a major role to make sure that the appropriate safeguards and transparency and accountability provisions are in place. And fourth, I would say that I would want to see companies like Tullow Oil and others move away from corporate social responsibility as a public relations exercise. I think Taro in Uganda has introduced a very good program on student scholarships, which is good. But I think the idea of companies, serious companies, going in villages and building one classrooms and this classroom, I think it's totally unacceptable. You want to be able to go and make an investment that makes a transformative influence on the society. And I think companies are not yet ready to move in that direction. Finally, I think that we need to be able to invest in small organizations that help communities to organize. We have a program that is supported by the Global Green Grants, a Boulder-based organization, you know, where you are able to get small organizations of, you know, civic organizations, opinion leaders that are able to help influence and manage and increase participation. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Godburn. I think your reflections really help us connect the human rights discussions with the transparency discussions, and that without rights to expression and rights to association, the transparency movement will fall flat in many countries. With that, I'd like to turn to Mohammed Amin Adam. He is the executive director of the African Center for Energy Policy, formerly the coordinator of the Ghana Civil Society Platform on Oil and Gas. Ghana discovered oil about 7 years ago, and has now significant experience, both positive and not so positive, to share with countries in East Africa and other parts of the world. So, Mr. Adam, I invite you.
Thank you, Ian. And let me take it from where you ended. Having been bombarded with challenging cases, you know, from some of our colleague countries from Africa, I would like to come on a positive note about what is happening in Ghana, but I'd also take the opportunity to draw some lessons from Ghana, which I believe could help in deepening the process in East Africa as you begin the processes of developing the policies and the appropriate legislations to manage your oil and gas resources for the benefit of the people. As you already know, Ghana discovered oil in commercial quantities in 2007, and to date, more than 70 million barrels of oil have been exported from the Jubilee fields. Oil is significant for Ghana for so many reasons. Even though production levels are modest, an average daily production of 100,000 barrels, it still means a lot for Ghana. Even though expected revenues from oil for 2014 will constitute about 1.2% of GDP, oil is still very relevant and significant for Ghana's development. And these are some of the reasons why it is significant for Ghana's development. In 2013, Ghana became a net exporter of oil, exporting about $2.6 billion worth of oil against $2.3 billion of oil imports. And oil indeed has overtaken cocoa as the second largest export commodity of our country. Secondly, in 3 years, the government of Ghana has earned $2 billion US dollars as its share of oil revenues. And this money is being applied to various development interventions in the country. Secondly, again, these revenues that we have received so far is about 70% of the facility Ghana is getting from China, the China Development Bank loan of $3 billion US dollars, for which Ghana collateralized the loan against our future oil revenues. Disbursements are slow, even though Ghana continues to pay a commitment fee of 1% on the undrawn balance. And Ghana is again compelled to sell its share of oil to China. This is why I think that oil is significant for Ghana. If we are able to manage these resources efficiently and according to our plan, we should be able to transform our economy and give real development to our people. And so as a result of the potential for transforming our country with oil, we were determined as a country since the discovery of oil to avoid the curse that prevented many resource-rich countries from transforming their resource world into tangible development outcomes. And so to date, we have made some important progress as far as oil governance is concerned. A petroleum revenue management law has been put in place with extensive transparency provisions and accountability mechanisms, including the establishment of what we call the Public Interest and Accountability Committee, which is a citizen-based committee exercising independent oversight on the management of oil revenues. We already have put in place the Petroleum Commission by an act of parliament, an independent regulator to regulate the operations of oil companies, including our national oil company. Local content regulations were recently passed in 2013, which seeks to integrate the oil sector with the non-oil sector of our country, covering issues such as local employment opportunities, equity participation, and domestic oil spending. But let me say that different players contributed to this positive development in our country. For instance, civil society organizations push for transparency, including the committee that I talked about, which is one of the unique features of our oil development. The World Bank also ensured that public discussions were held around proposals for managing oil revenues throughout the country. And let me also mention the companies, Talo Oil and Cosmos Energy, indeed published their contracts before the government did the disclosure of the contracts. And these are positive contributions other players have made apart from what the government of Ghana has done. But in spite of these developments, important challenges remain, which are likely to disturb Ghana's determination to break away from the curse. For instance, on the upstream side, there is no requirement in Ghana for open and competitive bidding process for oil concessions. And oil concessions are awarded through an administrative process, largely dominated by the political class. There is also no requirement for mandatory contract disclosure. Indeed, there is no requirement for the disclosure of beneficial ownership information. Ghana is still faced with poor institutional capacity to hold oil companies to their fiscal obligations. Oil companies conduct self-assessment for the purpose of determining their tax liability, and government just accept that, you know, for the purpose of determining how much taxes these companies will have to pay. On the downstream side, we have had problems managing our oil revenues. We are spending more of the oil revenues on oil and gas infrastructure at the expense of social and economic investment. We are spreading the oil money too thin over so many projects, and most of these projects have already suffered time overruns and cost overruns. And so value for money considerations are ignored, and this doesn't amount to efficiency of spending the money. Citizens do not participate in decisions on priority setting, and therefore government is using political considerations, you know, not guided by any development plan or any investment management plan to decide where to spend the money. And so 10 years on, it is not likely we can show anything tangible what oil revenues could have done for our country. Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I have a few observations to make, very important observations. There is absolutely significant political space in Ghana for civil society engagement with government. However, this, you know, space, you know, lately faces some challenges, you know, very important risk. One, the quality of the laws, you know, around oil has been weakened by too many discretionary powers given to ministers. And secondly, there is emerging collusion between the majority and minority side in parliament, you know, as far as oil contracts are concerned. And we have seen recent contracts approved without debate, with silence from both sides of the parliamentary divide. Let me draw some lessons from Ghana for our colleagues in East Africa. Number one, Ghana's laws are good in setting up oversight institutions, but these institutions are not funded. Two, there is incentive for vested interests to emerge at the early stage of oil development, and these interests are often perpetuated by the use of discretionary powers, especially the powers that are uncontrolled. You know, three, in order to meet the expectations of communities who are becoming impatient about the promise of oil, the temptation to embark on inefficient spending and ad hoc spending is very high. And finally, oil contracts that are signed before the discovery of oil or gas should give way to more progressive contracts after discovery. Because once the risk profile is assumed to have reduced, there is sufficient ground to negotiate higher fiscal terms to generate more revenues for the development of the countries. And so on this note, I want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Amin. And I know that at this point, with the time remaining, we're only going to scratch the surface of the complex issues that exist in the value chain that we talk about, from the licensing process to contracts to collection of revenues to budgeting and expenditure of those revenues. But I think there are a few key issues that I'd like to start off with along these lines. One issue that I think would be good for this audience in Washington for you to address is the role of donors themselves, the role of the World Bank, the role of the IMF, the role of bilateral donors. If you could comment on what is working in terms of their interventions in the oil and gas sector, what isn't working, and what would you like to see them do? And related to that question is this whole issue of capacity building. And when somebody says capacity building, it usually has a strong and profound narcoleptic effect on me. But I think it's an important question that we have to address. Looking at these problems as, and many of you said, are political problems that are approached with technocratic solutions and capacity building solutions from donors. For example, training MPs who then go back to Parliament and are whipped in line by the ruling party. Sending people to Norway from government who then have to return to Chad to do their work. Training journalists who then go back to their newspapers whose editors and owners say, we don't want to touch this issue because we'll lose advertising from the government. Or training government workers for the creation, for example, of a petroleum tax auditing authority who then leave to work for KPMG and advise companies on how to understand or game the tax system in a particular country. So there are all sorts of questions around capacity building, but I think everybody agrees that these issues are important. So if I could ask each of the panelists to touch on the role of the IFIs and donors and then address this issue of capacity building and what sort of capacity building might actually work. And maybe Adriano, you can go first.
Thank you very much. I think the role of donors and IFIs, it is fundamental in a number of reasons. One is that their support and their engagement with government comes with a number of good principles, such as transparency, and participation, mainly of civil society. However, in our experience in Mozambique, Mozambique is a highly aid-dependent country. We used to have a group of donors that support direct budget support, and international financial institutions such as the bank and IFCs and the likes. While the like-minded donors that support general budget support have been critical and supportive of a more good governance oriented, and they were ready to take a higher stand on that, with the discovery of gas, here we start to see different dynamics. I mean, they reduce their voice on the one hand, while on the other, from the government perspective, because they see that in the near future they will have gas, then they start to raise their voice. But looking particularly at international financial institutions, While they have been fundamental in supporting, in pushing for transparency, but when it comes to projects where they are directly involved, they have been disappointing in the sense that the same standards, such as transparency, take an example of making information publicly available, then that does not apply. And also in terms of principle such as human rights. One of the key projects that we have now, be it in the field of gas and in the field of heavy sands that are now active, they are there with the participation of the international financial institutions, IFC and African Development Bank. But these projects have been violating human rights. These projects have not been acting by example in terms of paying taxes. All these projects, they're involved in different schemes of avoiding of avoiding tax to government. So I think while they're important, but also there's a need for them to be transparent and playing for the standards that they advocate. Thank you.
Anybody else want to comment on this question? Godber?
Yeah, my response, Ian, would be that, first of all, we have to also understand who are the donors. Because the donors is not a homogeneous group. I think for a country like Uganda, you can talk of the World Bank. It has its own influence because of the lending arrangement it has with government. You can talk of the US and the UK. I think those are the donors that put a lot of money in government. So when you talk about influence, you are talking about actually three donors. And then of course, on the other side, you have China. None of us understand how China does its business with government of Uganda, so I may not be qualified to comment on that. Having said that, I think the kind of support that the donors can make, I think, is what they have been giving in terms of the improving capacity of governments in terms of the management, which is on the technical side. But I think where donors have not been helpful is really on the governance side and the human rights side, in the sense that the donors sometimes concentrate so much on the supply side. And I think Peter mentioned about, you know, training for parliamentarians, training for the judiciary. It's like, yeah, if you train judges, then you've solved the problem, but then the judges are not recruited. With one of the anti-corruption agencies, the Inspectorate of Government, for about 5 years, it didn't have the officers to be able to hear the corruption cases, but then you say we are supporting the IGG. The most recent one is really on human rights. I'm sure some of you may have followed this whole issue to do with the anti-homosexuality legislation in Uganda. Now, if you consider the amount of man hours that donors and government of Uganda have spent on that issue alone, and just not to say that it is not important, but only to say that the donors fail to understand that actually this problem is only part of a bigger problem of retrogression in terms of human rights respect and in terms of governance, and then we divert the entire discussion. So I think that the donors can be understanding by understanding the context within which they are operating and work with the local constituencies to actually broaden the scope of the horizon of thinking and the way they address issues. But sometimes, like this issue, it was just dealt with in the embassies and it ended there. And I think that can be distorting in terms of how you push the agenda.
Yeah, Amina, I was wondering if you could comment on this question in Ghana. Obviously, the World Bank, Norway, and many others have been assisting the government of Ghana to deal with the oil sector. Have those had an impact, and what have you seen that's worked?
Yeah, thank you, Ian. I think that the support from donors has made some progress, significant impact on Ghana's oil and gas development. I mean, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, citizens in Ghana would not have had the opportunity to discuss the proposals for for managing oil revenues, but for the trigger in the World Bank arrangement with Ghana for a facility that compelled government to go around the country to hold the discussions. And so that was very positive. I also know of a $38 million support from the World Bank, which was given to Ghana, a concessionary facility, to support capacity building of institutions that have mandate in the oil and gas sector. The Norwegian government is supporting the development of the new petroleum exploration and production law in Ghana. And so there's no doubt that there is support coming from the donors, which are very relevant to the development of the industry. But having said this, I think that what we need the donor community to do for Ghana is technical capacity. And I believe for the rest of resource-rich countries in Africa, technical capacity to determine the extent of accumulation of these reserves, of the resources that we have in the soil. Because if you do that, you have added value to our resources, and we are in the position to negotiate better terms, you know, and generate more revenues for our people. You know, another thing I think we need to do is to support us to develop and reform our tax systems, because there is so much leakages in our tax, you know, tax revenues that are coming from the extractive in industries. I mean, illicit financial flows, what we call capital flight, and some of the donors, including the bilateral donors, are also contributing to this problem. I mean, the United Kingdom government announced a public registry, for instance, for the disclosure of beneficial ownership information, so that we can be able to track the owners behind these, you know, contracts that we are signing with the investors, in order to track them for tax purposes and ensure that they do not use, you know, unorthodox means through transfer pricing, thin capitalization, and what have you, to take the capital that should come to develop our people out of the country. I am disappointed in the U.S. because when I read the action plan of the U.S. on the open government partnership, I saw a mention of the U.S. intention to promote the disclosure of beneficial information, but there is no commitment in terms of actionable commitment to ensuring that there is a policy or a legislation that will ensure beneficial ownership information is disclosed. And so we need support, technical support, but we also need commitment from our donors, you know, especially at the bilateral level, you know, to ensuring that you take the necessary steps, such as the Dodd-Frank legislation, such as the EU, and ensuring that the loopholes are blocked from your side of the equation.
Thank you very much, Amin. I think the issues around taxes are very important and sometimes get overlooked in the focus on payments and contract disclosure. And I was interested in, Prosper, your comment on perhaps this resource wealth would allow Tanzania to revise its tax regime so that it's more pro-poor and that there's less of a focus on consumption taxes than other types of taxes. So I'd be interested in hearing more about your thoughts there. But in general to the panel, before you spend the revenues, you have to collect it. And so what's the capacity in your various governments to actually monitor petroleum contracts, to audit production costs under these agreements? And also, do you think that as oil and gas revenues roll in, governments will make less of an effort on non-resource taxation? And there was a recent IMF research paper that showed a correlation between natural resource wealth and lower than average collection of non-resource taxes. So is this an issue and a concern for you as well? So it opened up to the panel. Prosper.
Yeah, thank you. When it comes to capacity, at least what has been done in Tanzania, I've just finished the study for NORAD on the assessment of the capacity that exists for the country to be oil and gas economy, specifically looking at the education that is needed, that exists, and the gaps. For sure, there are huge, huge gaps and huge needs for capacity building in terms of, you know, people that will be needed for this for this industry at various levels, at the government, at decision making, you know, in terms of policies, in terms of laws, in terms of procurement, and you know, the gaps are extremely huge. And as Adriano said, of course, when it comes to demand for labor, mainly they will be demanded in those first years of development, but after a while, when the industry stabilizes, really don't need so many people as such because it's highly capital intensive. But now, for what I think is extremely critical at the very early stages, our capacity to make correct decisions, you know? Correct decisions, for example, on fiscal issues, on tax rates, on tax systems for oil and gas. At the Tanzania Revenue Authority, for example, we don't have the capacity for, you know, extractive taxation generally, but then taxation of oil and gas specifically. It's an area that is really lacking. You know, we did some studies last 2 years, and we produced a report called $1 billion question, showing how much money we have not been able to collect from the mining sector, and specifically gold. And gold is something that we have been dancing with for the past 50 years. Now here comes this new kid in the block, oil. We don't know how the industry looks like. So taxation is really an issue. So I would say if donors, development partners would like to contribute, partly we'll be building capacity on how to properly tax these specific resources. Otherwise, we'll suffer a lot of illicit capital flight, those kind of things. And all the revenues that I'm talking here should be used for proper development. It will be a distant dream. Yes.
Charles.
I think the Kenya Revenue Authority has been one of sort of the more outstanding Kenyan institutions, but even then, it has faced challenges around transfer pricing and of multinationals, for example, in the horticultural sector. So, I mean, this is a worry for us as we move towards oil revenues. Thanks.
Yeah, I think I could add just to the credit of donors. I think the donors in Uganda have supported quite significantly the Uganda Revenue Authority. And I think, to be honest, Uganda Revenue Authority is one of those institutions in Uganda that you feel, is functioning, in terms of the way they have improved, even for some of us who pay taxes. You feel like, yeah, it is much easier for you to pay your tax. But sometimes you can have difficulties with these institutions. So I think that's something that I think the donors have done, and I think the commitment is really commendable. But also, I think to credit Touro Oil that last year they published the amount, the monies that they have paid to government, which I think is incredible because on the government side, you really don't see much coming out. And I think by publishing that information, I think Touro presents a challenge to government, also to be open. So I think it's a good practice that could help government be disciplined in the way it discloses information to citizens, but also help in terms of actually taxing some of the revenues that are accrued.
Yeah. Amin, this question in Ghana, does Ghana have the capacity to actually monitor and collect the revenues that are owed under these agreements? And if part of the problem lies outside of Ghana and these systemic problems around the global tax system. What are the most pressing challenges for Ghana in that regard?
Yeah, thank you. I mean, as I indicated earlier, our tax authorities do not have the capacity to hold oil companies to their, tax obligations in terms of, first of all, their ability to undertake cost audit, for tax purposes. And so the oil companies are allowed to do self-assessment, and which the government then takes to determine how much the companies pay to the government. We have been talking about the need for government to support the capacity building of our revenue agencies in order for them to undertake a serious cost audit of the operations of the company so that they can be able to realistically determine. But apart from that, our own law is not adequate. Our laws are not adequate because the petroleum income tax law, for instance, which governs taxation in the petroleum industry, does not provide for something like capital gain tax. And therefore, in spite of the many transfer of ownership that we have seen in Ghana, Talo acquired EO Group, Petro SA acquired Sabre, Ophir acquired Tap Oil's stake in the Accra, you know, block, and there have not been any payment of capital gain tax to the government because our law does not provide for that. You know, our law also promotes thin capitalization, you know, because when you go and take a loan to finance your project, and more companies are financing their projects with debt financing instead of equity, our law recognizes interest expenses as petroleum cost. And therefore, the more debt financing, the lesser and lesser the revenue base becomes. And therefore, government is unable to get revenues to develop the country. But as I said, we just don't need support to build the capacity of our revenue agencies, but we also need international commitment because the issue of taxes are global issues. I mean, it affects every country. Even the EU is complaining they are losing tax revenues. I believe in the US, you are losing tax revenues, you know, through capital flood, illicit financial flow. So let's have global commitment to addressing these issues in order to save the developing countries more.
Thank you. And with that, we're going to open up to Q&A with our audience. I'd like to remind you to keep your questions or your comments short. If you have a long comment, hold it for lunch. Let's see, we'll take three, starting with Robert.
Thank you very much. I'll be very brief. My name is Robert Hunja. I work at the World Bank Institute. And thank you, Ian, for soliciting some advice to people like us who are so-called donors. First of all, I want to thank my brothers. I'm from Kenya. I'm very proud to see you guys there doing what you're doing. Clearly, you're doing well to represent your citizens. I know there are challenges, and I want to just mention one of them. In 2006, I left the bank and went back to Kenya to be the director of public procurement in the Ministry of Finance. Okay, and one of the pieces of work we did was to try and understand the networks that enable a really, I would say, very corrupt procurement arrangement to continue. And one of the things that really struck us was the connections between the political class and the business class and the networks that support them. So the bankers and the lawyers and everybody else that goes to keep this machinery going. Yeah, and we were really struck by not only how well capacitated they are, but how motivated they are. When you look at the other side, the people trying to kind of change these systems, they usually stand alone. It's you guys in your little outfits. It's you know, some citizens trying to kind of, you know, run around shouting. And one of the things I would like us to think a little bit about is if we genuinely and very sophisticatedly understand the other side, and when you're talking not just regular procurement, but when you're talking oil and gas, the magnitude of the problem is really huge. How can we work with you to help you connect with others and strengthen your capacity to network, to share information and intelligence, to be able to push the issues that you need to push? Because I think until we begin to balance the capacity and the networks on the other side, a lot of these issues you've raised will continue to plague us. So thank you very much.
Thank you. And not to exacerbate regional disparities, I'll go to the back of the room. Noemi, if you could choose somebody back there.
Hi, my name is Mujobu Moyer from the Center for Global Development. My question is on public investment in infrastructure, and this actually goes to mostly Prosper. You mentioned that one of the ways that we could use natural gas revenues is to invest in public investment infrastructure. But public infrastructure investment is not a new phenomenon in Africa, and especially in sub-Saharan Africa. And we've seen in the past that most of the public infrastructure projects have suffered from low efficiency, particularly in East Africa. Tanzania performs pretty badly. There's been a recent paper by the IMF that has put together a public investment management index. And after Burundi, Tanzania is, you know, back there holding the tail. What do you think could be done differently to not repeat the same mistakes?
Thank you. And we'll take Philip in the front.
Thank you, Ian. I won't stand up so I don't block the view. My name is Philip Daniel from Fiscal Affairs at the IMF. My question relates to your earlier remark about capacity building, Ian, with which I have some sympathy. And I'm interested in what can be done to ration the scarce capacity that actually exists. Or to put it a different way, to reduce the demands on capacity rather than consistently focusing on it from the supply side. I give just two examples. All the countries in East Africa represented here have chosen contractual systems for oil and gas rather than tax and royalty systems. There's nothing necessarily wrong with that, many good positive things, but it's led to an evolution where every contract is different and every contract has to be separately administered. Is there a path of reform to that? The second is that there is an almost gut reaction when there's an accountability or transparency problem to say, let's set up an independent commission, a regulatory authority. The countries are littered with them. Does that not add to the demands on capacity, and does it not remove decision-making further away from the elected and accountable representatives of the people?
Great. So we'll start with that set. Prosper, why don't we start with you, because there was a question directed to you around public investment, and how could Tanzania and perhaps other countries in the region avoid the problems of lack of efficiency in public investment that have plagued these countries in the past? What needs to happen?
Thank you. Thank you, Moyo, for a good question. I'll be very general because if I'd seen specifically the reasons for this public inefficiency in this public investment, maybe I could know exactly what kind of solution to offer. But broadly speaking, I can just guess, being the person on the ground, knowing exactly how part of this public investment are tendered and all this, I think a proper tendering process, proper procurement process could be part of the solution, having really genuinely competitive tendering. I think it could be part of the problem, part of the solution. And I'm talking this with some example from, best practices from the Millennium Challenge account for the US. Tanzania has just accomplished one, and we are hoping to get a second one. And I was partly involved in making evaluation of such projects. And I think partly, there were projects that really went relatively well, road projects, infrastructure projects in terms of, electricity, power, water. And part of the attributions as to why they went well are, a procurement process that was more, open, transparent, and all this. And I'm not sure exactly the specific examples that Moyo is saying, but I know public procurement, it's a problem. But also there are problems that are associated with disbursement of funds, that yes, contract has been signed, and then funds are dispersed 2, 3, 4, 5 months later. Inflation has gone up and all this, so there is really no proper accomplishment on time, on budget, and specifications. But then there are also some problems associated with vested interest, where I am the player and I'm also the referee. I'm giving the tender and I'm evaluating the tender because my company is involved, those kind of issues. So corruption in a nutshell. So I think, broadly speaking, when it comes to there's a public investment, those could be part of the, part of the big problems. And I think it's related to what the colleague was speaking about, what Robert I think spoke about, procurement as to what could be done, what the donors could be doing differently. And I think the whole thing about you putting conditions, because at times you are giving funds to fund some of this infrastructure. If you give it on an open check kind of, then they use it exactly the way they want. So I think you could put some conditionalities on how the funds that you are giving should be spent. The anti-corruption, signs and all kind of things. But at the end of the day, really, whether we have laws and regulations, really, I think that should of mind. Those who believe in God, they say the fear for God. Maybe should be the solution, There was somebody once told me, maybe you have to wipe out a whole generation in order to get things going.
Well, I hope that's not the solution. Robert had basically a question about how groups like the World Bank and others could coordinate and network and share intelligence more with civil society groups around these kinds of procurement issues, noting that there's absolutely no lack of capacity on the side of the lawyers, the bankers, the consultants, and their collaborators in government, and those who are trying to extract leakages, as it were. Do you have any thoughts on how that might happen? Charles?
I think Robert's intervention was very critical. And I think one way of it, and sadly, what happens is a lot of these are sort of developed relationships. So, I mean, if we could find a way, I'm not sure we can be able to institutionalize some of these sort of personal relationships that you develop that help you. But I think in terms of constructive engagement, I think it's providing those opportunities, the networking opportunities involve sort of a level of inclusion of civil society in constructive engagement. So just, I think, sort of moving beyond the box ticking or sort of, you know, consultation agreements to more sort of networking arrangements based on issues that are coming, arising. I'm not sure I've been very clear on that.
Maybe thanks.
I could just add on Charles's point. I think Robert, the point you're raising is so fundamental in the sense that, as you've mentioned, the networks that are involved in these kinds of corrupt deals are fairly sophisticated. And I think that the only way you actually engage them and deal with them is that you have to develop almost equal sophistication on the other side. Because just working with government of Uganda on a number of policy processes, we've learned over time that public officials will only give you audience if you have something to offer on the table. It's not just enough to go there and say you go there and complain you're unsatisfied, but you even don't know what you're satisfied about. So we've learned that actually for African civil society organizations like these seated on the table here, you have to develop certain levels of technical and analytical competencies to be able to match the skills and the expertise on the other side. So if there's anything that we need to do, even in terms of dealing with these complex issues, I think it's for our organizations must be able to invest in building that analytical capability, and there is no shortcut, because the issues that we are dealing with are very complex, or if we don't deal with that analytical competence, then we can only be activist organizations who are going to always say, oh, World Bank, don't come here, you are a problem, you are this and that. Yeah.
Yes, Adriano.
Thank you very much. Well, my organization is an anti-corruption civil society organization. We have developed an electronic system that traces the interests, economic interests of the political people in the country. So you can access what are the economic interests of my president right away from your laptops. Just log in, put his name, you will find everything.
Who shows up at your house? Somebody shows up at your house?
Yes. And our expectations were that after having delineated all this, we would engage constructively with the business people for them to understand that it is in their interest and of the society that there is a level playing field. But the response was not satisfactory. So it seems that it is in the interest of the private sector that there is no proper transparency. So the current system, it enables key interests to prevail. So it is not an issue of capacity, but whether the private sector currently will be receptive to such interests, because private sector, structurally, it is still small. So I don't really know. I have no answer to this, but just to put it on table to be considered. Thank you.
Thanks. Amin, you wanted to say something, and if you had some thoughts about Philip's question around rationing scarce capacity and giving the example of how some contractual arrangements may be to make a bad pun, more taxing on the government than others?
Yeah, first of all, what I think is going to happen to Africa is that with the discovery of natural resources, the influence of our donor partners is going to go down because our governments are getting the new leverage to call the shots. And most of them may not be interested in committing to some of the transparency principles that are being promoted by the international community, the IFIs, and the donors generally. Apart from that, because of the discovery of this new world, some of the donors are scaling down their support because they want to move from countries with discoveries to countries that are more poor, you know, to support their efforts at development. And so the influence is going to go down, but the scale down in their support is also going to reduce opportunities for civil society activism. And so what I think we need to do is how we can refocus our support on building not just civil society organizations, because the discourse is being reduced to a convenient relationship between organized civil society like us and government. And so the larger citizenry are left out of the discussion. And so how can we focus our support to reaching out to the larger citizenry? For instance, some of the information that have already been disclosed by government, how do we get that information to the larger citizenry? Through social media, information technology, forums in communities, so that beyond the organized civil society, the larger citizenry are asking questions, relevant questions. How much are we earning from our contracts? Where are we spending the money? What is it delivering in terms of quality of service? And so if the World Bank Institute is to work with us to build that critical mass of holding to account duty bearers, including us, who are leaders of organized civil society, I think that will be very progressive in ensuring that we do the right thing. But coming to the different contractual relationships, I think that the issue should be reduced to parliamentary capacity. Because for most of our countries, our constitutions give parliament the power to ratify the contracts that we sign. And I do not think the power of ratification is just gymnastic. It is to allow the representatives of the people, and through that, the people, to decide whether the terms negotiated on our behalf as primary owners of the resources are in the best interest of our country. But we know that parliament doesn't receive as much support as government does. And so if we have to ration existing capacity, we need to look at parliamentary capacity. I think it's very important. In my country, for instance, in Ghana, I am increasingly losing confidence in parliament. And not just me. Many, many people in Ghana are losing confidence in parliament. But how do we blame parliament? They are not given enough budget. Committees cannot sit. When they want to do public hearings, they cannot fund it. And international organizations have to fund it. A public interest and accountability committee has been set up to exercise independent oversight. No budget has been given to them. Revenue Watch and GIZ have to buy office furniture for them. This is serious. And I think that until we reach in that capacity and rechannel it to building the capacity of parliament, who are the true representatives of the people. I mean, what is happening in Ghana is worrying also because government is now rushing contracts through parliament, because government wants to escape a process which it has started itself. Government has begun consultations on a new petroleum exploration and production bill, which is much more progressive because it is proposing a competitive and open bidding process, it's proposing contract transparency, it's proposing the disclosure of beneficial ownership information, and we don't understand why a government that has begun the process of passing a progressive law should rush contracts to parliament ahead of that law. But if you have a stronger parliament, they will put a stop to that. The right to information law has been pending in parliament for only God knows how long. Why will they pass that law? A law that will be used to check their abuses. And so I think that we need to refocus that capacity to parliamentary support, but also what I said earlier, to building the capacity of the larger citizenry to appreciate the kind of information that goes out there and to use that information as leverage to demand accountability of our duty bearers.
Thank you, Amin. And on that note, unfortunately, we're going to have to close for lunch.